Thank you for that very fine invitation.
Gracias
Thank
por
you, Dr.
su invitación. Gracias, doctor. Muchas gracias. Voy a dar cuatro presentaciones, de hecho, que están muy vinculadas.
The first presentation
Hoy es la primera.
Some very difficult patients and what I want to accomplish is to help you understand why patients who have something mild like irritable bowel syndrome gets more severe and gets chronic and they get severe psychosocial difficulties and then how do we treat them. So what I want to do is begin with a case history. And picture of this patient came to your office. The woman is 33 years old.
She's
referred for chronic and severe abdominal pain with constipation and refractory. That's been refractory to treatments. She's had recurrent abdominal pain since beginning at age 6 when she stopped going to school. This increased after she began having her period.
Después de
at
que
age 19,
empezó a tener su
she
periodo,
began traveling through
a los 19
Mexico
años, empezó a viajar por México,
and had a gastroenteritis, which eventually became a post-infection gastroenteritis
post
with fever, diarrhea,
tuvo
and
fiebre,
vomiting,
diarrea,
which
vomitos,
then continued.
Y esto continuó.
But over the last 10 years,
pero en los últimos
10
años este dolor se ha vuelto más frecuente y en los últimos 5 el dolor es constante y está asociado a constipación, llenura, a estreñimiento y no se alivia cuando hay movimiento intestinal. También tiene migraña.
She was put on a variety of medications,
se le dieron muchos medicamentos,
see,
como pueden ver ustedes ahí, antiespasmódicos, inhibidores de bomba de protones. Nada de esto ayudó. La solución PEC tampoco ayudó
she had multiple
a su estreñimiento.
As you can see.
Había tenido múltiples
she
procedimientos,
inclusive
una laparotomía exploratoria hace 5 años cuando le diagnosticaron la endometriosis. Y se le dio leuprolide de nuevo sin beneficio.
3 years ago,
hace tres
she had a cholecystectomy because of a lower ejection fraction on HIDA scan. Now,
ahora,
in the last years, she's been
años,
to the emergency room over 30 times.
Por
she receives morphine and
Phenergan.
She goes home with hydrocodone or
oxycodone.
Her family physician refills these narcotics.
Vuelve
to prevent
a llenar esos narcóticos para evitar que haya visitas repetitivas
She's
a las emergencias. Ha tenido 5 hospitalizaciones por dolor
room
was cuando no tuvo éxito en la sala de emergencias con el tratamiento de fue hospitalizada antes de ir al consultorio de uno. Cuando tuvo una segunda laparotomía exploratoria que fue negativa, tenía cada vez requería más morfina y no pudieron mandarla a la casa porque todas las veces que trataban de quitarle la morfina, el dolor empeoraba.
They called in a psychiatrist, and I won't go through this whole history,
no voy a revisar
except
toda esta
to say
ustedes,
that she had major depression and post-traumatic stress disorder from early childhood due to sexual and physical abuse,
abuso sexual
and the rest of her life was difficulty leaving home
difícil.
Early. Leaving her spouse who was physically abusive to her,
pronto, muy temprano,
and now she's unable to work,
su compañero,
and she's
su
on disability,
no puede trabajar,
and the psychiatrist recommended she go on an antidepressant.
Ahora
she was discharged from the hospital eventually on an SSRI medication, which I'll show you later today is inappropriate, it's the wrong treatment, and oxycodone, which is also the wrong treatment. So now she comes to your office.
Ahora it's Friday la consulta afternoon, de un viernes por la tarde,
4:30 in the afternoon.
A las 4:30 de la tarde.
There she is curled on
y
the table
está,
with her hips flexed.
Toda
she complains of severe
con
pain.
Las caderas flexionadas sobre la mesa. Se queja de dolor tremendo, dolor en el abdomen medio, inferior con náuseas. El estreñimiento es malo, no se le ha movido el intestino en 10 días. En el examen abdominal tiene mucha llenura en el lado derecho y mucha sensibilidad. Ahí se reconoce una impactación fecal, requiere hospitalización por el dolor y que se le den medicamentos intravenosos. ¿Qué hace uno en este caso? Usted y tiene planes
well,
de ir a comer a las 7 de la noche. Bueno, esta introducción era para darles una idea de qué tan mala puede volverse la situación y si podemos lograr cualquier cosa en este momento es hacer que ustedes entiendan lo que está pasando. Cuando el paciente llegó hace un par de años mi consulta, la había visto un residente gastrointestinal y yo no estaba allí. Cuando regresé, me dejó él este mensaje. Dr. Jones,
Mrs. Jones is here, help me, what do
la señora
I do?
Jones está so aquí.
I think the
ayúdeme,
point is that when
entonces,
you see this patient, it really can
paciente,
generate a lot of frustration, feelings of helplessness,
and
really
que no
not having a good sense
no
of what to do. That's what I want to try to do
eso
in the next 16 or 17 minutes.
Que
so
me quedan,
this patient progressed.
Este paciente progresó,
she began with what was called recurrent abdominal pain, which is a behavioral condition
que es una
often seen in school children. She developed post-infection IBS in Mexico. She then went from IBS with diarrhea to IBS with constipation. Then she developed what we used to call functional abdominal pain, we now call centrally mediated abdominal pain. And then the phenomenon, particularly in the U.S., I don't know how much it happens here, she got involved with a large amount of opioids and she developed opioid-induced constipation and something we had described about 7 years ago.
Opioid-induced
central hyperalgesia, or what we call narcotic bowel syndrome. So just to refresh you, I think the point is that when we talk about IBS, we're talking about recurrent pain that's associated with defecation and change in bowel habits. That's how she began. And then what we saw is that she had IBS with diarrhea, and this is one of the findings of Rome 4, is that these are not
estos no son condiciones fijas. Los pacientes pueden moverse o pasar de diarrea a estreñimiento, inclusive a estreñimiento funcional sin dolor o diarrea funcional sin dolor. Entonces pasaba de diarrea a constipación y después a dolor abdominal crónico.
She developed what's called visceral hypersensitivity, which means that as you stimulate the bowel, usually with rectal distension or it could be inflammation, the pain response increases compared to normal people.
This is visceral normal. Hypersensitivity
or an abnormal pain response to a stimulus
anormal,
to the bowel. Usually we understand it in terms of eating or stress or things like that. So she had visceral hypersensitivity. She still has IBS. But over time,
tiempo,
as she continues to have these symptoms, continúa
teniendo
she continues
los
to have psychological distress, as I'll show you, the signaling from the brain to the gut and from the gut to the brain in this vicious cycle leads to chronicity. And that's
just
a result of a left shift in the stimulus response where normally you have a greater pain response to any stimulus. So if you put a balloon in the rectum and you stimulate it in the healthy person, it might be over here where they start to get pain, but in IBS with sensitization you get greater sensitivity, increased signaling. And now
sensibilidad
you get
aumenta
a
la señalización y hay una mayor respuesta del dolor, esta es la hiperalgesia. Y puede tener también alodinia, que quiere decir alodinia, que es una respuesta inocua. Alguien con IBS come algo pequeñísimo y tiene un dolor tremendo. Habría que comer una comida inmensa. Nosotros, por ejemplo, para tener un dolor de ese estilo. Entonces, ¿qué es lo que produce la sensibilización visceral? Inflamación intestinal o problemas de la mucosa, como enfermedad intestinal inflamatoria.
An alteration or dysbiosis of
alguna
the bowel, or trauma to the intestines.
Trauma a los intestinos.
When I was in training, there were lots of operations
había muchas operaciones
for,
que se hacía para
peptic ulcer disease
enfermedad de úlcera péptica antes de los bloqueadores H2, y esos pacientes volvían con dolor crónico.
If you're a guest, when you do a colonoscopy on an IBS patient, you might expect more pain in this patient than if someone's coming in for a polyp resection, because they've been sensitized.
Porque se han sensibilizado.
So we do know that about 25% of people will get post-infection IBS. It's initiated by an infection. It's also associated with increased psychosocial distress. I've been working with the Institute of Medicine in the federal government to look at the soldiers who come back with IBS and post-traumatic stress. And they have the war trauma, plus they get a gastroenteritis. And a good proportion
el problema gastroenterológico y muchos de ellos desarrollan IBS, así que puede ser trauma por la guerra o cualquier tipo de estrés importante como en esta mujer. Entonces el modelo que estamos mirando es que las infecciones por microbios, en este caso mirando por ejemplo los soldados o mujeres que han sido abusadas sexualmente, afecta el reconocimiento de la bacteria, lo que lleva a un aumento de la permeabilidad intestinal, y se lo voy a mostrar a ustedes, lo que a su vez lleva a una regulación hacia abajo ineficiente y la combinación del estrés, de la angustia, a su vez lleva al IBS, que eso pasa por la disbiosis o las bacterias malas. Voy a mostrarles, la angustia, el estrés puede llevar a la liberación de citocinas de CRH, que es una hormona proinflamatoria, y acetilcolina. ¿Y qué hace esto? Que lleva a degranulación de los mastocitos, y la degranulación de los mastocitos puede liberar péptidos y después migrar hacia arriba. Aquí que ven ustedes en verde, comienza esto a desaparecer y se aumenta la permeabilidad. Y estas toxinas también activan las fibras nerviosas produciendo hypersensitivity, as shown here. And as this continues, you get a transmigration of bacteria, and the cycle perpetuates. This is not too different from IBD. It's just that it's a different genotype, and you don't see morphologically ulcers and inflammation, but microscopically, you have to altered immune dysregulation. Now, here's where it gets really challenging, because in this woman, because it continues over and over again, with the stress and with her life, she gets what's called central sensitization. In animal models, that's called wind-up phenomenon. With repeated stimulation to the bowel with her IBS, you get increased signaling at the level of the dorsal horn going to the brain. So now, because of increased signaling, the pain gets worse. That's central sensitization. And then what will happen is, I'll show you, we have a problem with the brain unable to downregulate. I'm afraid that your irritable bowel has progressed. You now have furious and vindictive bowel syndrome, so now it gets really severe. And what we see is that the central nervous system contribution to pain is associated with the chronicity of the illness. If someone comes in with a bowel obstruction or cholecystitis, they come from a general population. They don't have psychosocial difficulties. You take out their gallbladder or relieve the obstruction, and they're fine. But when you start getting chronic illness like IBD or GERD, it affects you psychosocially. Will I be able to go back to work? Will I be able to socialize? When you get an IBS or functional, you have greater contribution. Will I can't get out of bed. And then eventually, with chronic abdominal pain, you have severe central contribution. I'll show you this later for the sake of time, but the point is that centrally mediated abdominal pain, as she developed, is continuous pain with only occasional or no relationship to eating or defecation. So I tell the GI residents, if the patient says the pain is there all the time, not better or worse with eating or defecation, this is brain hypervigilance and hypersensitivity. And here's an example of that. When we look at perception threshold in IBS shown here, compared to controls shown in blue, you see that with distension, they have a lower pain threshold. But look at the functional or central abdominal pain. In this study, they're no different than normals. So they're having severe pain, but they don't have this visceral hypersensitivity. They have central hypersensitivity. So as you go from mild to severe, as this woman did, what you're seeing happen is the pain gets more severe, and the peripheral factors that you normally would use to treat her, like probiotics or chloride channel agents or FODMAP diets, won't work. No funcionan.
They will have tried it, but now she's got disinhibition or a failure of the brain to downregulate these signals. It's like a volume switch turned up, and this is enabled by all these psychosocial factors. She has sexual abuse and physical abuse. We did some research to show the clinical outcomes in patients with abuse history. And as you can see, the severity of the abuse, from no abuse to attempt to contact to rape, leads to greater progression in outcome over 1 year of severe pain, other GI symptoms, more disability. These patients are at greater risk for surgery just by having a history of abuse.
tener historia
and then
de abuso
functional disability.
Y discapacidad funcional.
They're more likely to go to the
más
doctor.
Posiblemente
so
van
when
al
you're
médico,
seeing patients like her, the likelihood of her having an abuse history with this clinical presentation is about 80%.
Es más o menos
the more severe the pain, the more the disability, the more you have to look for it because it's the failure of the brain to downregulate that leads to this. The other thing that happened with her is opioids. Opioids started to affect her GI tract, slowing everything down, giving her more severe constipation, reduced secretion, increased sympathetic flow, and then central sensitization, which we'll cover. These are the side effects of patients who have opioids for non-cancer pain. You can see it affects the whole GI tract. Everything slows down. They get nausea, they get abdominal pain, heartburn, bloating, and so on. So, in the U.S. now, we're starting to characterize the opioids into opioid bowel dysfunction, which is the effect on the entire GI system with the nausea, ileus, pseudo-obstruction, vomiting, and then because of the pharmaceutical companies, we're now treating constipation specifically, which is the opioid-induced constipation. And then we identified this narcotic bowel syndrome, and I don't know if you've seen it here, but this woman has that, that as you continue to give them opioids, the pain gets worse, and the only treatment is taking them off opioids. So, of all opioid users, about half will get about some bowel problem, and about a smaller, two-thirds of that will get constipation. And narcotic bowel syndrome, or centrally induced hyperalgesia, occurs whether or not you have constipation, because it's happening in the central nervous system, not in the gut. I told you about the narcotic syndrome, and this is the characteristics that the pain keeps getting worse. But it's a central nervous phenomenon. It has to do with activation of the dorsal horn glial cell, which is a pro-inflammatory cell. It's a cell that becomes activated with infection or opioids that then leads to release of cytokine kinds and excitatory amino acids, which upregulates the pain at the level of the dorsal horn, creating more central sensitization, and you get increased pain. Here's a rat model to show you that. This is done by Bueno's lab in Toulouse, France, where they took rats and they looked at abdominal pain response based on the number of contractions. And as you can see, that when they gave the morphine group morphine, the contractions dropped because they got analgesia. But after about a week, they started to get more pain response and more contractions, and that's the opioid, the narcotic bowel syndrome in the animal model. And they've done some studies to show how you can block that effect. Her psychological diagnoses are major depression and post-traumatic stress disorder. The pathophysiologic of this is now moving up to the brain, that the brain is acting to regulate. You know, we've called, and I'll tell you this in the next presentation, these are not called functional bowel. We're changing it to disorders of gut-brain interaction because it has to do with the regulation between the brain and the gut. And in these conditions, it's not just what's happening at the gut, but how the brain is doing to turn down or modify those signals through the gate control mechanism. So psychosocial factors, expectation. We did a study to show that women who had surgery, pelvic surgery, for non-painful disorders, the ones who developed pain were the ones more likely to believe that they were going to have the pain. So expectation and conditioning plays a role, altered cognitions, mood, as this woman had, and as I'll show you, this can have effects on brain structure. Brain imaging study we did on patients with abuse to show you that those with abuse history compared to those who don't or who have IBS alone have greater pain scores to rectal distension, which is associated with anterior cingulate mid-cingulate activation.
Activación
so we have a window to understand this area
is at
a connection point between emotional state, primitive emotional states like abuse, and also cognitive function and pain regulation, and it's altered in patients with the trauma history. Now, in the last few years, one of the most exciting areas in science now, for good and for bad, is that we learned that chronic pain or trauma or severe psychiatric disorders can lead to degeneration of nerves in the brain, neural degeneration, which is related to neuroplasticity. And here's some data from various studies from investigators going back about 10 years, even with painful chronic pancreatitis, there's evidence that there's a dropout of neurons in the brain, which was involved with regulation of the pain. These are the patients with chronic pancreatitis where the ERCP is normal. They've had pancreatitis before they become sensitized, and now they have more central sensitization. Here's evidence to show that in the anterior and cingulate in IBS. Well, I'm not going to go through the antidepressants. I'll be in the one of the green room, the name of it, at 3:50, and I'll be talking about the use of antidepressants. But what we do know is that these antidepressants may regrow the neurons that become degenerative. The dorsal ganglion stress and disease due to genetic susceptibility can suppress neurogenesis and be associated with depression. And then using these treatments, and this could mean also cognitive behavioral therapy or hypnosis, can lead to restored neurogenesis. Well, as I said, the management approach will take tomorrow because I'm running out of time. But what I want to try to show you is that when you see your patients with functional GI disorders, IBS, and chronic abdominal pain, look at their lifestyle. Look at their severity. When it's mild, you can do things by explanation and reassurance and lifestyle advice. When it gets more moderate, you start to use pharmacologic agents targeted to the gut. The probiotics, the antibiotics, the chloride channel agents, and so on. But when it gets more severe, you need to look at the multidisciplinary treatments and the antidepressants. So what we have is the spectrum from afferent excitation to disinhibition enabled by psychologic stress, and there the treatments are behavioral antidepressants. And as I'll talk about it at 1540 this afternoon, augmentation or combination treatments. Oh, I forgot to mention that when we treat these patients with narcotic bowel, we take them off the narcotics, and you can see that the pain goes away. If they stay off the narcotics for 3 months, the pain scores on a visual analog is 1/4 what it was when they were on the narcotics. Hard for patients to believe this, but you take them off the opioids and they do better. When they go back on narcotics, the pain goes back. All right, I will, I think for the sake of time, end. Thank you.